Do we have pushes? Do we have sometimes we have to work 70-hour weeks, 80-hour weeks? Sure. But we make sure that that is extraordinary. And that in reality, we also know that nobody ever on their deathbed said, gee, I wish I spent more time in the office. So that balance of work-life balance gets a lot of lip service, gets a lot of say, but we take it very seriously. I've had employees come to me and say, I've canceled my vacation because I know that I've got to be here for this critical thing. And I say, great, you do that again and you're fired. There's two reasons for that. One is, if you have made yourself so critical to the organization that you can't leave and it will fall apart and for your 2-week vacation, you're not doing something right. You got to learn to delegate. You got to learn to bring up people you trust. And the best way to find out if you can trust them is to leave for 2 months or 2 weeks, I should say, for a vacation, or 3 weeks. You know, we're in the United States. We talk vacation in weeks, not months, like they sometimes do in Europe. So we do emphasize that. And then the other thing is, making sure that you understand the technical, the frustrations of a technical person working in a bureaucracy. Every company has a bureaucracy, some smaller, some larger. In fact, every business in the world, nonprofit or profit, is a process that takes less money to produce something of value to the customer than the customer is willing to pay. And so you do have to have a certain amount of process, and especially in our world, we're in the life support world, you've got to be extremely rigorous on process. And that's probably my hardest part, is you get people to say, oh, we got to do this fast. And, oh, by the way, we don't want to do this process because we can do it faster. Well, I try to instill on people, you never do things faster by skipping a step. It's by doing steps faster, but you still have logical steps in what you want to do. So there's all that gathered in with being a leader in a company and making sure that the company doesn't rely on the backs of its employees working 70 hours a week and only getting paid for 40 to make a profit. That's just not sustainable, and it's not fair, frankly, in the long run.
And that is fascinating. The focus, you have much more of a focus on compliance because of the thermal control world that you're in than, say, Joel Sercell at Momentus, who is pushing forward with 40 engineers he hired this week to break stuff as fast as he can, right? Because he won't kill anybody the way that your guys would, right? If they skip process steps. So form is following function there. That's very interesting. You personally have published more than a dozen papers about life support and thermal control. And I'm curious, out of those, what has been the most important to you and why?
Wow. I would really two come to mind there. One of them I co-authored with a friend of mine named Dr. Leslie Wickman, who's famous for having written the book, The God of the Big Bang, which I recommend reading, where she tries to make sense of the fact of how you can be a scientist and a rigorous scientist and still be a religious believer. But what we did was, back in about the late 90s, early 2000s, there was this idea that to build a long duration spacecraft, you had this curve that was all the different spacecraft that had been built, and it was the number of people and the number of person days that it was designed for a mission, and the volume. And there was this line in there that was, okay, so if we want to do a multi-month mission with 3 people, that's X number of person days, that now the volume should be 1,500 cubic meters or something like this. And we wrote a paper that, without saying it, pretty much called bullshit to that, if you pardon the expression. And we call it activities-based design. So when we were involved with the first layout, say, of the Orion vehicle, really it's the form follows function. What are you going to do? What things do you need to do in your spacecraft? Then what volumes and what spaces you need to do what you want to do? It turns out, of course, as you get longer missions, you do need a little more volume. It doesn't really have anything to do with livability. What it has to do with is, once you've gone past a few weeks, you can't have a timeline that's every second of the day for the next 3 years what you're going to do. So you have to have team meetings that where you get together and you say, what are we going to do? So you have to have a place where they can do that in the spacecraft. And in the space station, there's in the Zvezda module, they have an eating surface area. They do that a lot. And the other thing with the activities-based idea is that it also then really pushed a little bit of the thinking about how do you do EVA? Because one of the big volume constraints is the extravehicular activity. How do you get in a suit? How do you get in with a buddy? How do you have two people in a suit? Because you never send one person with a suit and not somebody else. And you've seen a little bit of the manifestation of the thought behind that now in these expandable airlocks. So the idea is, yeah, you're right. We shouldn't be allocating this much space inside a spacecraft. Let's do an expandable airlock. So it had a lot of knockdown effects, and that you are now seeing in almost every design. And there's been a fair amount of references back to that. On the other side, back when Orion was going on and before Dragon, of which we were the systems designers for life support, and at that time it was Rocket Plane Kistler, but it's now Boeing who's doing another human vehicle. We actually sat back and said, what is the best way to design the life support system? What is the pressure you should be at? What you know, the shuttle did 14.7, but then they had to knock it down to 10.2 PSI before they did an EVA for pre-breeding. But there's an optimization there of how much pressure and what the constituents, how much oxygen, what percentage of oxygen. We did that paper back in 2004 or so, and that got a lot of people thinking about why do we do what we want to do for a brand new vehicle. Some of it's been ignored, some of it hasn't, but I think it really did a service to the industry to really take the data from prior missions and explain why they did what they did. I mean, there were so many brilliant people that worked on Apollo and Gemini before that and Mercury, and just throwing away that without thinking about why they made the choices they did, they did as much as they could, and they really, really sharpened their pencils on those programs. But if you don't understand why they did it, you might very easily design something just like it and not realize why, and then find out your parameters are no longer supporting what really happened. So I think that was an important one too. And then of course we have ones about our technology. Why our humidity control technology is better? Why our urine processing technology is better? And those are all important too, but they're a kind of less overview and much more down in the weeds, so to speak.
Right, but you've got a couple there that have really impacted the industry. More engineers are not going to solve your problem. It's not a technical problem in that sense. It's a process problem. And the time to fix your processes was 20 months ago. And the second best time is today. This is Jason Kanigan, the president of Cold Star Technologies and the host of this podcast, The Cold Star Project, which is all about identifying and solving process problems for space companies, because that's what we do. And you can hear the entirety of this episode by following the link in the comment below.